Digging Deeper. We are live. It is 7 o'clock, and I am so excited to be here today because I've got a coworker of mine.
Hello, everybody.
We work together at Henry Ford, so I'm super excited about that. And we've got a special topic for you. So our topic today is color, reflections, and memories. And this is Joel. How do you pronounce your last name?
Geffen.
And we both work at Henry Ford College, which is exciting. So I'm just going to jump right in. I'm going to let you talk a little bit about who you are. Who are you, and how did you get into photography?
How much time do you have?
As much time as you want to take, and then when it's too much, then I'll stop you.
All right. Those of you who know me know that I can talk for a long time on small topics. Just ignore this glare as I'm trying to be a little bug tonight. But who am I, and how did I get to photography?
Yeah.
Like a lot of people, I've had a camera since I was a kid. Mm-hmm. And I photographed normal things with that camera. I photographed my dog, photographed the lake we lived on, photographed the family.
Yeah.
Then later, as a young adult, I got a degree in forestry. So my first degree actually is not religious studies, which is what I do for Henry Ford, but it was forestry.
Because
I'm a nature boy.
Yeah.
And I would use the camera to photograph stands of trees, their health, how tall they are, how thick they are.
Wow.
So it was documenting. But also in my spare time, I would walk around and there were waterfalls or neat rocks down in the creeks or logs that had fallen across.
Yeah.
So I'd photograph that.
Yeah.
Later still, I worked as an archaeologist for a Native American group in Washington State.
Oh.
And then I'm using a camera to document stone tools that I found, or pieces of stone tools, or trails, or cabins, or old fence lines, foods and medicines used by the elders.
Wow.
So I was using it that way.
Yeah.
But also on occasion, because there were these great fields of flowers called camas, beautiful purple spikes, and they went literally forever with snow-capped volcanoes in the background.
Wow.
Just amazing. I would photograph that. So that's kind of how I started documenting for my work. And then in 2009, there was a lot going on in my life, and I knew that I needed something bright. I needed something happy. I needed something uplifting.
Mm-hmm.
And I was living in East Lansing.
Okay.
I was teaching at Michigan State.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a little school called Lansing Community College.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a magnificent photography program. And I'd heard about this program. And one day I thought, I'm going to go see if I can get into this program. I'm going to go see what it is. And so I went over to the school, and the head of the program walked me into different rooms. And so there's a room with all these big soft boxes, the big rectangular black covered boxes with the white sheets in front that you see in portrait studios.
Yeah.
Those, other lights, rooms full of computers, students' photography on the walls.
Mm.
And each room just looked better than the one before.
Yeah.
I thought, oh, this looks really cool.
Yeah.
So then I had to take the math test.
Oh, to get into the program?
You had to take the math test. And I'm one of those who can't add two and two and get the same answer twice. But I studied and I studied and I, right, there we go. I studied and I got help from a good friend of mine named Ellen. And I went in and I took that test and I didn't do real well, but I did well enough
to get through.
Slide right in. I just slide in. And that started. And so I took the basic classes, which I loved, black and white photography. There were all kinds of cool classes, introduction to your camera, and each time you had to do projects. I loved doing the projects, and I just ate this stuff up. I photographed, I made friends, I did the projects. I had a great time. And at the end of that year, I was going to take a job teaching at the University of Vermont. In Burlington. I had been offered a job, I had accepted, and my father passed away. And that changed everything for me. So when my dad died, I unraveled.
Mm-hmm.
You you know, I don't want to be overly dramatic, but that's what happened. It was a big deal to me.
Naturally so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't take the job. There wasn't enough of me left to take the job. I couldn't do it. There was no way I could have done it. And so I let the job go. A friend of mine was offered that same job, and she and her husband and kids are still there. So that part's good.
Yeah.
And it was at that time that I photographed that one image of the reeds. Maybe we can get to later. So what happened, to try and wrap this up a little bit, is I gave myself a second year in the photography program. And my father was never a professional artist, but he was a painter my whole life. He was a sculptor of odds and ends. He was really creative. And I thought, okay, my father is gone. What can I do to honor my dad? And also, I was a wreck. And I decided I'm going to go for a second year at this program. I'm not going to work. I'm going to use this tiny inheritance to take myself through school. And I did. And I finished that second year, and I produced a black and white image that won an award. And that image is still in the permanent collection of the school.
Oh, wow.
So that, in that Lansing. Was not, right, so it's in Lansing. And after that, I said, okay, I'm a landscape photographer. I was a forester. I was an archaeologist. I can do this. I got an award. So I decided to move back to where I grew up, which was Florida.
Okay.
I grew up in Miami. I'm a South Florida boy. We wear these kind of shirts. Yeah. A lot of color. So I went back to Florida thinking I'm going to be a world-class landscape photographer. Yeah. Clyde Butcher, move aside. Didn't quite work that way. So I went to Florida and ran into some challenges because I wasn't done grieving my dad. So it didn't quite launch the way I thought. And after a while, I moved up to Tampa, where I had a close friend. And just to try and get my feet under me, I went over to a photography museum, the Florida FMOPA, Florida Museum of Photographic Arts. And first I went there and think, I'd like to get my stuff on the walls here. Like, I can do this. I walk in and there's like Andy Warhol, and there's like, that's not happening.
Like, it's, let me step back.
Just like,
this is
going to
humble me a little bit.
Right. No, this is not what I thought it was. But I was taken by it enough. I asked, do you guys ever need any help? Is there anything I could do volunteer-wise? And they said, well, we have a docent program. And so I volunteered to be a docent, and their training was excellent. So it was a top-notch, top-notch photography program. So they hosted artists like Andy Warhol. That was the first one. Dianora Nicolini. Who else was in there? Ansel Adams, just before I arrived. But all high-end stuff. And you get trained not only on their art, but their background, who they are as people. Why did they create that kind of art? And then you give tours. And I did that for some time. And while I was doing that, the museum offered workshops, little workshops, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, and I took three. And the last workshop I took was with a guy by the name of Pierre Duterte. So Pierre had a workshop called Focus on Your Talent. And there's a chance that Pierre will watch this, so I'm going to be good, don't worry.
Hopefully he'll be giving a good reflection of who you are.
So my time with Pierre actually changed my direction, changed my life, and in really good ways. So merci beaucoup, Pierre.
What was it that changed your life? What was he teaching specifically?
Well, the class was focused on your talent, and the idea is that you are to figure out what your truest photographic talent is. The idea behind it is that not everybody is equally good at everything. Maybe you're an excellent photographer when it comes to portraits, and that's great. But that may mean that landscapes are a little harder for you to conceptualize and photograph well. Or maybe you're excellent when it comes to landscapes, but it may be that sports or babies or seniors are difficult. You're not that good. So how do you focus on what you're best at? So I went in there determined
to do landscape.
I was. It didn't work, but I was determined. I'm going to figure out my talent. I'm going to figure out my artistic vision. Yeah. I've been trying to figure this out for several years. I haven't done it. So here I go. I go into the first night, and I have at least 40 digital slides, at least. All broken into four categories. It's like, I'm going to lay this stuff out there.
Yeah.
You tell me who I am.
Yeah.
And so he goes around the room, and most people had like three slides or six slides. And I'm sitting there going, I know I have 40 slides.
And they're good.
and I'm hoping they're good. And we go around, and so there's somebody who's photographed banana trees and flowers in their backyard. Mm-hmm. And he'd say, well, that's beautiful. It's a very nicely done.
Yeah.
And then another individual photographed dogs, and that was nicely done. And went around the room, and everybody's stuff was pretty good.
Yeah.
Then comes my giant and stuff. And I'm thinking, okay, I hope he says this is good. So he goes through, and he looks at my first section, editorial, which is people and narratives. He's like, eh.
Okay.
And then landscapes, which I thought, I'm good at this. I mean, I've gone to workshops. I've got this degree. And he says, yeah, they're not bad.
Wow. Okay.
Then he looks at my portraits, and he was, let's put it this way, he was exceptionally unimpressed.
Wow.
And in front of the class, let them know he was unimpressed.
Wow.
And then I had this tiny little category of close-ups and abstractions. I wasn't doing that kind of work. It's just once I had like four or five, and he looked at those and he said, some of these are interesting. And so I'm thinking, I'm a landscape photographer. We go around the room, he talks, we're going to get our first assignments.
Yeah.
So the person with the banana leaves, please photograph some more banana leaves and flowers in your backyard. You've done a beautiful job. Maybe watch the shadows over on that side a little bit.
Yeah.
The dogs, very beautiful, but maybe be careful of that lamp over there. Just move your camera slightly this way.
Yeah.
Went all the way around the room, and I'm thinking, okay, it's my time. I'm going to do landscapes. I'm a landscape photographer. And he says, he looks at me and he says, I want you to produce, I forget, three or five pure abstractions. I'm thinking, pure abstractions? I don't even know what an abstraction is. And I'm thinking, really? Really? Abstractions.
Like, did you not see all the landscaping images?
Yeah, like, look at this. These are good landscapes. So for a week, I tried to photograph a pure abstraction. I had to read about it. Like, what is this?
Yeah.
I don't even know what this is. And then I read, okay, so it's like the painters, like Kandinsky and others, and circles and lines, like all out of their imagination.
Yeah.
There's nothing representational. There are no mountains, no people, no rivers.
Yeah.
They're just objects, right? They're shapes.
Yeah.
Well, with photography, you're going to photograph basically what's in the world. So how do you do an abstraction?
Mm.
So I did my best. I worked all week long.
Yeah.
Went to the local botanical place and photographed little petals and little flowers and tried to get super close.
Yeah.
Work with the geometries. I go back and we all meet. Again, we go around the room. Those are lovely banana leaves. And the dog images are great. And this image... And we went all the way around the room, and I'm thinking, just make it stop. I don't want to do any more abstractions. And he gets to me, and he looks at me and says, and I'm waiting for the word landscape. And he says, for next week, 10 pure abstractions. I'm going, no, no. Tell me. So what that did is it kicked off. So that was 2010 or 2011.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still photographing abstractions.
Wow.
And
so he put you sort of on a path.
He put me on a path, and he was initially fairly unflattering with what I was doing, and that's fine. Actually, that's fine, because that ultimately is a lot more helpful than somebody giving you false praise.
Yeah.
Because when he did see something he liked, I knew he really meant it.
Mm.
And that also gave me direction.
Yeah.
So I have ended up letting landscapes go until this summer.
Mm-hmm.
And I have been photographing close-ups and abstractions for all these years.
Wow.
And Pierre is someone I consider to be a close friend.
Wow.
talk.
Hopefully
with him.
He likes your work now.
It's better. It's better, like a little here, a little there.
Welcome to everyone who's on, by the way. We have Hassan. He's one of, I had him as a student. Maybe you had him as a student too, Henry Ford. And Kamau and Christina, welcome.
Welcome, everybody. So that's how I got started. And that ended up leading me into art fairs. It ended up leading me into learning.
Yeah.
And ultimately developing my own course, which I teach privately on how photographers figure out how to determine what their greatest talents are.
The next question, obviously, how do you do that? But before we get into, I do want to ask you some questions about the course that you teach. But before we get into that, one of the things that I've noticed about you is you're very drawn to different colors. And there was once I was passing by his office and I was wearing like a burnt orange and kind of like this, like a maroonish type of color combination. And you commented on it because my eyeshadows were the same colors of the scarf and the outfit I was wearing. And it was very faint. It wasn't like it was, you know, bright. It was like pretty subdued, but you commented on it. And I was like, this guy notices colors. He knows colors. So what got you into thinking of colors in that deeper way? Because some people are into it and some people don't really. I think, you know, everyone has, we focus on different things, you know, and maybe color is something that you focus on, and music for other people, sounds for other people, what have you.
Well, let me see if I can answer that. So I think in order to understand me and my love of color, you have to go back. So this is the memory part of the title.
Yeah.
And the reflection part. So we're all brought up in certain places. Like I have friends brought up here in Michigan that love the gray skies. And I'm not saying that to be funny. But to them, it's normal. They have their own beauty. There's a softness. They really like that.
Yeah.
Me, not so much. I grew up in South Florida. Yeah. Big blue skies, maybe 6-7 miles from the ocean.
Yeah.
I spent a lot of time in the Everglades canoeing and hiking. And everywhere there's color.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of color, and it's big color. It's reds and oranges and yellows and flowers and leaves. And often people paint their houses in fairly vivid colors, and you have red tile roofs. And because it's Miami and there's a tourist trade, there's a lot of chairs and tables that are sold in tangerine and teal and aqua. So there's just a lot of color.
Yeah.
And I think I internalized the place, which has big blue skies and beautiful bays in the Atlantic Ocean.
Yeah.
And I internalized all the color that I saw around me all the time. And I'm biased, but you've never seen a sunset until you've seen a South Florida sunset. And so I think all that just kind of went in. It just went in.
Yeah.
And so even though I haven't lived in Florida in quite a while, that attention to color and that love of color is still there. And to be honest, I didn't know I had an affinity for color at this level until I'm 62. And I didn't know it until just a few years ago at this level.
Yeah.
But now I do know, and I pay attention, and I think about, oh, those are complementary colors.
Yeah.
Oh, those are analogous colors.
Yeah.
And I do look at people's makeup, and I do look at their clothes combinations, and I look at the paint jobs on their cars and the colors in their houses.
Yeah.
I do. I pay attention to all of it.
What do you see in the colors here when you first walked in?
Soft. Right? So I didn't even necessarily think, oh, that's a green or a gray or whatever.
Yeah.
I thought, it's more the feeling.
Yeah.
It's the feeling. And the feeling in this particular room is soft, it's gentle, it's relaxed, it's quiet, even contemplative maybe. And for someone like me, that's great.
That was exactly the intention.
Was it?
With this room, all of those words is exactly the intention.
Very nice.
So what colors are you drawn to?
I tend to be drawn to fairly bright colors. Not bright like fluorescent lit up over the top bright, but I like when I painted, there's a cat down here.
Yep.
Hi, kitty. of when I've painted or helped paint the interior of a friend's house. Mm-hmm. One room was a bright yellow. In fact, we call it the banana room.
Wow.
But it's bright.
Yeah.
And so when you sit in there, you can have a cup of coffee and it feels uplifting. It's bright. It's cheerful. It's good.
Yeah.
And then in the kitchen where her counters were kind of, I guess, 1970s era, kind of a mustardy yellow.
Okay.
We painted the wall this beautiful sort of blue, almost as if you were in the Greek islands, maybe.
Okay.
And so the colors played off.
Yeah.
And then each room, we paid attention to the colors. So if you're going that way, you want to be able to, the color behind you or surrounding you, to work with that color. So no matter where you are in the house, no matter which corridor you look down, the colors are working.
Yeah.
The whole thing was this magnificent experiment in color.
Wow.
It was great.
Yeah.
So I like big, fat colors. I like bold colors.
So what colors do you have in your home?
Well, it's not my home, so I have the colors that came with it. But they're not bad. They're soft. They're pastels. They're not bad. Probably my least favorite color is the light blue.
Mm.
And that's because it's a cool color.
Mm.
And Michigan, for me, is cool enough already.
Yeah.
I don't need to augment that.
Like, I need something brighter.
Give me something brighter. Give me something warmer. Bring a little sun into the room.
Yeah. Well, it's true, though, too, because what you're talking about is color will make you feel a certain way. It'll, like, yellows will make you feel a certain way. I love different shades of blue because I love going, being in Michigan, you always go to the lakes, and I would just love sitting by water.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
And so that calming feeling.
Yeah, and it'll do that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it'll do that.
Or green. I love green. I feel like it makes me feel alive and connected.
Right, like the green of nature kind of green?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And are you a born and raised Michigander?
Mm-hmm.
Right, so it's perfect.
Yeah.
Right? And if you go to where I grew up, you have the blues, but they're not the same kind of blues. They're not as cool.
Yeah.
They're a lot warmer. They're subtropical, tropical bodies of water, so the colors are different.
Yeah.
Right?
That's true. So different shades of them and the depth of that color. That's interesting. So one of the things you were talking about when we talked earlier with respect to the class that you teach is, and you alluded to it a little bit, about how memories affect your art.
Right.
And how memories affect perhaps even what colors you're drawn to, what colors you might photograph, or what things that you're drawn to photograph. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. I hesitated with the little bit part because I can go on a long time, but I'm going to try to be reasonably brief.
Well, hold on. We have one question I'll just bring it
ahead.
Up before.
Yeah, go
Do
ahead.
You think that shapes have the same effect on emotions as colors?
Ooh, great question. Hmm. I don't know. I love shape. I'm also drawn to forms of different kinds, and there's no question to me that, at least in terms of my response to forms, it's a visual response, but it's an emotional response as well. For example, when I plant or help plant flower beds, I don't particularly like rows, and I don't like things lined up like this.
Mm.
I like S-curves because they feel better. If I'm looking at forms of lamps or chairs or tables, I tend toward round as opposed to things with sharp edges. Because the sharp-edged ones emotionally feel too hard. They feel a little bit unyielding. I like the roundness. So I would say, for me at least, forms do have an emotional content. They don't have an emotional content, but we respond to the form with an emotional content.
Mm.
And for me, that's important, but I personally respond to color even more. They go together.
Yeah.
Actually, they go together.
Yeah. I definitely like things that are curved and rounded a lot more.
Yeah, that's a great question.
That's a great question. Hello to everybody who's on.
Hello, everybody.
Hi. Oh, Marie is on. Hi, Marie. Memories. We're talking about memories. That was the question you were going to talk about before we got to this question. And if you guys have any other questions or comments or anything, you know, with respect to your own photography or your own art or things that you're drawn to, please feel free to share.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm happy to stop what we're talking about, what I'm saying, to address your question. Be happy to do
that.
Yeah,
of course.
So just feel free. So memories. So the class that I teach has a title that suggests that through your photography, you can get to who you are, like down deep, not on the surface. If you look at most photographs, and I think I'm safe in saying this, and not just photographs, probably paintings as well, they tend to be of fairly predictable subjects. Fairly predictable. So if you look at landscapes in Michigan, you will see the Great Lakes. You may see colored chairs at the lakeside. You may see pilings. You may see maple leaves in autumn turning color. Predictable. Very predictable. And because they're predictable, they generally aren't very personal. It's like we know culturally, because of how we're raised, that maple leaves are beautiful and desirable in color. We know that mountains are lovely because we've grown up with Sierra Club calendars and advertisements of nature. It's like in our head, we know this makes a good photograph.
Yeah.
It's like a template. It's like in your head. True. It's there. And so you go out, you pick up your cell phone or your camera, you go click, click, click. There you go. But it's not, and I don't mean this in a bad way, but it's not particularly personal. You're not really saying anything. Not that you have to.
Yeah.
But I think for most people, if you take their photographs and you spread them out on a table and you look at them and then you start asking questions, you'll find that people tend to take certain kinds of images. So even if we're working with a snap shooter, oh, there's quite a few sports images here. Yeah. Or there are quite a few images of your wife, your husband, your son, your daughter, your cousin. There's more of those.
Yeah.
If you then ask more questions, like why? That's the question. You've got to be like the perennial five-year-old. Why? Oh, why did you photograph that? Why did you photograph this? What drew you to that? What drew you to this? Why aren't you taking those? How come you're not taking those? So who are you? Who are you?
Interesting.
Who are you? And the first hurdle is to get over the mistaken belief that any photograph is objective. We tend to think, as a culture, probably worldwide, that photographs record reality and that's one of their greatest strengths. That's what my grandmother really looks like. That's what the rouge plant really looks like. But it's impossible to be objective. Impossible. Even computers aren't objective because somebody programmed them with certain biases to do certain things.
So if you had five people and you said, okay, take a picture of a rouge plant.
All different.
They're all going to be different.
All different. They could stand in the same spot. They could trade that same spot and they wouldn't be the same. I was photographing with a friend in the Upper Peninsula a number of years ago. And there was a concern that what we were photographing, if we stood in the same place, would look the same. But it turned out we did stand in pretty much the same place and it did not look the same.
Wow.
It did not look the same. His eye, that is to say, his way of seeing the world and my eye, my way of seeing the world, are not the same. So when you stand there, your mind goes to work and it starts looking for things that you like. And what I like and what you like may very well not be the same.
So if you looked at those two images, was the difference what is being focused on, as well as where the frame is, like where does the frame begin, where does it end? Like, what were some of the major differences that you saw?
If I remember right, and Chris, if you're watching, you can just jump right in and correct me. But so I think Chris was probably focusing at full standing height. So your tripod is here, your camera is here. So it's normal human height.
Okay.
And that gives you a certain view of what you're looking at. There's a certain landscape orientation, if you will. It's a strong horizontal or a strong vertical.
Yeah.
Probably with Chris, I imagine it was more horizontal, but I don't remember exactly. And he tended to photograph more grand vistas, if I think about the photographs on the walls of his home. And he does beautiful work. I tend to photograph vertically. And there's a difference because when you're looking horizontally, you're looking at an expanse. Your vision is going out. It's taking in lots of information, right? if I orient the image vertically, I'm constraining you. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, look right here. Look right here. And I tend to, instead of shooting at this height, I tend to get lower because I'm trying to pull the textures out of the ripples in the sand. So I want to get lower where that's emphasized as opposed to a larger landscape, for example. So even though we're standing in roughly the same place, we were not photographing the same thing in the same way.
Wow.
We had different interests.
I'm just thinking of myself when I take pictures. I'm not a photographer by any means. But whenever I take pictures, I tend to take them landscape. Mm-hmm. And I tend to tilt them up because I love clouds.
Oh, great.
So I always have clouds in my images.
Oh, that's awesome. I'd like to see some of your work.
I mean, it's not my work. It's really just, this image. Yeah.
So if you were in that class with me, mm-hmm. I would be asking you, what is it about clouds that you like so much? Mm. Like, why clouds? Why not water? Why not rocks? Why not trees? What is it about a cloud or clouds that pulls you in?
I like water as well. A lot of my images are water mm-hmm. or clouds. But for the clouds, back when we used to have those flip phones, like the Nokia flip phones, right. and the images were really blurry, I still took images of clouds. And I think I was always drawn to the abstract shapes uh-huh. that clouds take. They're all so different. Each, like if you focus on this left side, it's going to look different than right here. Just like a couple inches over, if you look over, it's going to look different. And I loved how clouds seemed really ethereal and kind of wispy on the ends, and just sort of reminded me of something metaphysical, something that's just greater than this world.
You are perfect. And no, I'm not paying her for what she just said, but that's perfect. That's actually perfect, because what you just said is how my students work also, but you're a lot, you went there much quicker than we did when we were. And I'm still working with my students.
Yeah.
But as soon as you start using words like ethereal, mm-hmm. metaphysical, that suggests to me that you're bringing something very personal.
Yeah.
And it's no longer just a photograph of clouds.
True.
Yeah. Like it is a photograph of clouds. So let me make a distinction. I don't want to be too technical, but I think this is important. And this comes from Pierre. So mm-hmm. I'm borrowing from Pierre. Thank you very much again for this. There's subject matter and there's actual subject. Mm. Subject matter is what's in front of your lens.
Okay.
I look out here and I see clouds. Mm-hmm. That's subject matter, clouds. Okay. That's what's in front of the camera. Actual subject is what you bring to the table. Mm. It's what you are really and truly photographing. Mm. If you and I had a longer conversation, particularly about the ethereal or metaphysical qualities, that's actual subject. Mm. That's way more than just clouds.
Yeah.
That's Allah, right?
Yeah.
That's, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
I'm guessing now, but it's the
divine,
indescribable greatness, the boundlessness.
Yeah.
And now we're getting closer to why do you photograph what you photograph. Mm.
And it's interesting too, because a lot of the artwork that I have, this is a good friend of ours, Malika Arts, look her up. Whenever I have her do artwork or give her colors, or whenever she does it, I feel like we're drawn to the same things. You'll notice how there's oranges and yellows that sort of go up to the top, and the same thing here. And it's the same thing. It's sort of reaching up.
Rising.
To what's beyond.
Right. Rising, expanding.
Yeah.
So this is exactly how it goes. So if we were to have a conversation about why do you photograph what you photograph, if you back up, it started with, you told me, I'm not really a photographer. And we talked about the Nokia flip phone.
Yeah.
And it's just clouds. But all of a sudden, just
clouds. But now it's something more.
We would take away words like just. Because if we're talking about, for you, the divine, the metaphysical. There's no just.
Yeah, that's true.
There's no just because it's too large, too great, too boundless, too important to be just.
Yeah.
Right? Like, my understanding is Allah is not just merciful.
Correct.
Boundlessly merciful.
Correct.
Right?
Yeah.
Boundlessly just. Omniscient. There are no limits.
Yeah.
Right? So there's no just. And those are no longer just clouds.
True. Maybe that's one of the reasons I'm probably so attracted to water as well. It's endless.
So that's, it's that kind of process by which you start figuring out, why do you do what you do?
Yeah.
And it has to do with how you're raised, how I'm raised.
Mm-hmm.
Has to do with where you're raised. It has to do with your personal history, your group history. It has to do with all these influences that make you who you are. They all come together because you're a unique human being. And when you put that cell phone up or that camera up, you're not just looking through a machine. You are. But you're the one who's framing. You're the one who's doing the selecting. And it's not as random as you might think.
Do you have a lot of students who are in your class and there's like these aha moments?
Sometimes.
That's going off.
Yeah, and when they are ahas, they're big ones too. They are really, really big.
Yeah.
Or they can be. They can be really, really big. I'll give you two examples. I won't use any names, but just two examples. Or three. I'll give you three.
Okay.
So one example, there's a woman in the group. Most of the people are women. There's a woman in the group who is very, very interested in macro nature photography.
Okay.
And in our conversations with the group, it's emerged over time that what she is interested in, what bothers her, this is the thing, what bothers her is when people hurt other forms of life needlessly. So it can be trophy hunting. It might be stepping on a bug when you don't need to step on that bug. But it's about life. And I don't know that she would necessarily use the word sanctity of life, but it starts moving in that direction. So her subject might be butterflies, frogs, wisps of grass tops in a field. But what it's really about is how beautiful and wondrous the world is and how worthy it is of admiring and protecting. That's one person. Another person typically photographs ruins overseas and flowers. So arches and windows and doors and stairways and rocks on the ground and little flowers. And it took quite a while until we finally figured out one day that the issue is ephemerality. Ephemerality. The fact that things come and go. Her history, it turns out, is Armenian.
Okay.
Her family is one of many families who fled the Armenian genocide. When I would ask her questions, it would be, my family has no roots. We don't really belong here or there. You have to protect and preserve memories. Well, what's memory? Well, rocks. Not just rocks, but ruins, right? These are human-built structures that are somehow still persisting despite the passage of time. Flowers are these delicate, beautiful little beings that come up in the worst of circumstances, and even when they die back, they'll come back. They'll set seeds or perennials through the roots. So while she's photographing ruins and flowers, that's not really what's going on.
There's something deeper.
Something deeper. One more person in the group, and I'll finish with this. I'll just say, came through a very difficult childhood. Let's put it that way, like really difficult. So she photographs a variety of images, but most of them have water or filtered trees, that is, different filters you can use in a camera or in your computer to change the way the image looks. But you end up with a very soft look. Why? Because for her, she's a Christian woman. And for her, it came down that her images aren't so much about this stretch of water rendered nice and smooth and flat. or even this set of trees, it has to do with the fact that she finds peace in God.
Mm.
And all of these places, reminder of that peaceful feeling. Mm. So the subject matter, it might be rivers or buildings or trees, but the actual subject comes out of her experience, mm. her memories.
Wow.
And what we're doing is reflecting on all of that,
yeah.
and trying to say, okay, so let's see where this photography goes. If you focus,
yeah.
no pun intended, but if you emphasize what you care about, let's see where this goes.
I feel like right now, I'm like, that's what's happening right now. Because as you're talking, I'm thinking, I'm scrolling through images that are in my phone right now.
Uh-huh.
And I'm just thinking, like, so many images that I take, even I'm thinking, like, I went to Morocco a couple of years ago and I took a lot of images of stairs, but it was always going up. And it's like, where is it going? It's sort of endless. And even images that I took of water or images that I took of the mountains. The other thing that I tend to take a lot of pictures of are cats.
Cats are great.
I have, everyone at work makes fun of me because when I came back from Morocco, I had an entire album of cats in Morocco. Cats in front of beautiful doors, cats in front of, like, on the stairs, cats by the beach, just cats. Tons and tons of cats. Let's take a comment here. Christina said, so do you think, let me come closer so I can read. So do you think photography can be a form of therapy if people take the time to look and search for the true meanings behind their concepts and ideas for a shoot?
Absolutely. No, there's no question. There's no question. So therapy, I'm not a therapist, but my understanding, therapy is a form of healing, right? It's something that you do. We say it's therapeutic, it's healing, makes us feel better. And art has been used to help people move through trauma for a while,
mm.
right? There are entire college programs and others that you can go through in art therapy.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes cameras are put in the hands of veterans who have PTSD so they can look at what their experiences are.
Mm-hmm.
Here in Dearborn, I know... I think it's the Arab American Museum that has a program for children.
Mm, I didn't know that.
Photographic. But the idea is that if you take the time to be reflective, and it that's the reflection part of this
yeah.
title, right? You have to be reflective. Once you get at what motivates you, and that takes a while to get there,
mm-hmm.
then if you, it takes courage, but you can start photographing with an eye toward exploring that topic.
Mm.
But you don't have to do it directly. Like, you can photograph flowers and ruins. You can do
yeah.
it that way.
Yeah.
But I'm trying to say yes to your question that photography, painting, sketching, sculpting, weaving,
mm-hmm.
cooking. I mean, there's many forms of art, right?
Yeah.
But I'm talking about photography mainly. But these all can be very therapeutic, especially if they're coming from a place of self-understanding.
Mm.
But that self-understanding takes courage because most people don't want to go there.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of ick in there.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of scary stuff in there for most people, including me.
Yeah.
But that's where the goodies are, too. There's, I don't remember the name of it, but in Japan, I believe it's an art form where cracked pottery vessels are...
Filled with gold.
They're put back together and the breaks are filled with gold.
Mm-hmm.
And in a manner of speaking, I think it's as if to say that's how we are too.
Yeah.
That where we're broken, where we're cracked, where we're wounded,
mm-hmm.
done well, which I mean in a self-reflective way, so
yeah.
we don't hurt ourselves or others,
yeah.
that can be a beautiful spot from which to work with other people.
Yeah.
Right?
That's true.
Like, if you've been hurt, maybe you can be extra caring
mm-hmm.
for those who've been hurt.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So,
absolutely.
The answer to your question is definitely yes.
That's true. I mean, for me personally, when I started the show, one of the biggest motivators was reflection. This idea that if we self-reflect and if we reflect as a community, that it brings about positive change, because it then forces you to turn within. And if you're turning within and you look at the things that maybe you don't want to look at, that in it of itself, hopefully, will make you softer with other people. But
there you go. There you go. Yeah. Yeah. And that's a beautiful gift.
Yeah.
Right? And if you look at art, so I'm not talking about decoration. I'm not talking about photographs that are purchased or created because they go with the couch or because they go with the cat.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not that. But art. Art is, it's a form of communication.
Mm-hmm.
That's art.
Mm-hmm.
Art communicates. So if we look around this room, and I believe I'm looking at calligraphy, highly stylized calligraphy in many cases.
Every single one of them has calligraphy.
That there is meaning behind the writing. There's meaning behind the colors. There's meaning behind the figures. So we're looking more at art than just pure decoration, even though it has a decorative function.
Correct.
Right?
Correct, yeah.
So to go back to your question about whether it can be therapeutic, yes. And I would say that the more you speak out of your heart with a cell phone or a regular camera, allow it to be therapeutic. Allow yourself to go to those places. You're more in line of creating art.
Mm.
You know, and art is something that others tell us, right? Society gets to say if it's art or not art. But what we can do is come at it with a big heart.
Yeah.
But part of that big heart is we have to know what's here.
Mm.
And you have to admit what's here.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's nice and sometimes it's hard.
Sometimes it's hard, yeah.
Hard.
Are there certain assignments that you give to your students or that you have been assigned when you've taken courses? Because I know you were telling me you had an assignment recently. Are there assignments that you give or that you have that are difficult, that are really challenging?
Definitely. I think when I give assignments where I ask my students to self-reflect. That's hard because most of them don't. It's like they are open to self-reflecting, but when it comes down to it, it's difficult, and then there's points of resistance.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to photograph that. That's not very pleasant. I don't want to think about that anymore. That was not a fun part of my life.
Yeah.
But the thing is, you can't get away from it. Because whether you deny it or don't deny it, it's in your work anyway.
Yeah.
It's in your work anyway. It's there anyway.
Yeah.
Right? It's just like you go through your day and somebody says something and you respond or you react.
Yeah.
It's there anyway, so might as well work with it. So when I give assignments, sometimes they're embraced by my students, and sometimes there's a little resistance or a blend.
Yeah.
I've been working with this group for almost a year.
Wow.
And we're only now at the point of starting to develop portfolios.
Wow.
And that's going to be tough.
Yeah.
Six finished images. By finished, I mean thoughtful, well photographed, well edited. That hang together as a group. To come up with six that are done and work together, you have to take quite a few. You have to really think.
Yeah.
So there's that. So in terms of me receiving assignments, when Pierre first started giving these assignments of actual subject, like subject matter, actual subject, I had a really hard time because I would go, okay, my subject matter is, let's say, a lake. Actual subject, I like lakes. why did you photograph that flower? Because pretty.
Yeah.
It's red. right?
Yeah.
And he would say,
dig deeper.
Yeah, right. So give me more, give me more, give me more.
Yeah.
And when I started figuring out what I was really photographing, why, I actually didn't like it. I still don't like it. I still don't like it.
And so that's, how do you come to terms with it then?
To be honest, I haven't completely come to grips with it. What I know is that, I'm going to keep this very general, is that there was a very significant event in my early life. I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
And I buried that significant event for most of my life. And then in my 30s, it started emerging all on its little own. And my father's death in 2009 pulled the lid off, and then I needed to deal with it because it was too potentially destructive.
Yeah.
So when I as honestly and authentically as I can answer Pierre's questions, mm-hmm. I have to look at that stuff.
Yeah.
And the sad thing for me is that I don't want that stuff affecting any part of my life. Mm. Not my art, nothing.
Yeah,
I don't
yeah.
even want it there.
Yeah.
But then it's actually beautiful in its own way because it's out of that that I care for my students, for example. Mm. It's out of that that I care for my friends, for my family, for pets that I have.
Mm-hmm.
So it cuts both ways. And maybe
yeah.
Cut's actually not a bad word. That wound, that slice,
yeah.
it is something that hurts, and it's something from which I can give.
Mm.
So the assignments I give to my students can be challenging,
mm.
and the students that I receive as a student, because I'm still a student,
yeah.
can also be very, very challenging. Mm.
I'm thinking about what it must be like to be in a classroom setting where you have, even if it's a small, especially if it's a small number of students, that each person really has to lean into their vulnerability. And if a question like that is being asked, you have to then be honest not only with yourself,
mm-hmm.
but with everyone who's in the room.
That's right. That's right.
And that's tough.
Yeah, it is. It is. What I find in my small group of students is they're very mutually supportive.
Hmm.
You know, there's no fake support.
Yeah.
They really open their hearts to one another.
Hmm.
And not in a saccharine way. It's
hmm.
just that they're there for each other, and
yeah.
nothing ever leaves that room.
Hmm.
Whatever is spoken in that room stays in that room. It doesn't go anywhere. We are just supporting one another. And I have to be really honest. And what happens when I'm honest and open like that? Because
mm-hmm.
sometimes I'm working to help somebody talk about a memory that's not so easy.
Mm-hmm.
I get really tired,
yeah.
right? It's like teaching.
Yeah.
You get drained.
Yeah.
But it's also, for me, a tremendous honor to be trusted at this level.
Because mm-hmm.
they're trusting me with their
yeah.
lives, right?
Yeah.
They're literally saying, I haven't told anybody this, but here's a little piece.
Yeah.
And so I have to be gentle with that. I have to honor that.
Mm.
And then if someone gets uncomfortable, back up.
Yeah.
Let it go. Don't push it. Don't
yeah.
ever push it.
Yeah.
Never.
Yeah.
And then just kind of, it's a dance, right? It's like,
mm.
okay, we're in this together, and
yeah.
we're going to go down this road. And the portfolios, when they get there, they're going to have some meat on those bones.
Yeah.
It may be a butterfly or a frog, but underneath that, there's going to be an artist statement that lays out why.
Mm.
Or it may be a block of Roman ruin and a flower, but there's
yeah.
going to be an artist statement that lays out why.
Mm. Okay.
There will be titles that give some suggestion of what's really going
what's
on
happening
here.
There?
What's the actual subject? What do you bring to the table?
Mm-hmm. That's a lot.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, to go back to what Christina was saying, that is very therapeutic.
Yeah.
And I would even say, I mean, as an instructor, or even when you were in Pierre's class, were there a set of ground rules of, this is, we're going to honor one another, we're going to respect one another, we're going to make sure that what happens in here, we're not sharing people's stories with anyone else because it's not our story to share. Were there conversations like that that took place, or it was just sort of naturally, organically happened?
I think, if I remember right, it was naturally organic. So my... the initial class with Pierre, these kinds of things were not discussed in that first larger class.
Mm-hmm.
That these kind of topics weren't discussed. But a year after that class,
mm-hmm.
he said, would you like to take not an institutional master of fine arts, but sort of his equivalent of that, if
mm-hmm.
you will? And I said, sure.
Yeah.
I'd love to do that. So I'm doing that with him, and this other guy is. So there's only two of us.
Yeah.
And I've met, they're in Tampa, Florida, I'm here. So mostly it's Skyping or phone.
Mm.
And I don't think we ever had to set ground rules, but the respect, the sincere respect
yeah.
is so great.
Yeah.
Nothing ever goes anywhere. It's just so solid.
Mm.
And Pierre is great, and the other guy is wonderful as well. It's great stuff.
That tends to be the nature of artists who are very authentic. Everyone who I've met, because I mean I'm in the music scene, and everyone who I have met who creates music that is from someplace deep within them tend to follow this code of ethics, if you will, that you just know. You just know how to treat one another. You just know how to honor one another and respect one another. And there's a genuine care to not just appreciate the art, but appreciate where that art came from.
It's a nurturing. It's a kindness and a nurturing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? It's a kind. Mm-hmm. And so if we go back to what I do for a living, that is teach comparative religion.
Yeah.
I can't think of any tradition that I've encountered.
Mm-hmm.
So we have the major traditions, Hinduism, Buddhism, mm-hmm. Judaism, Christianity, Islam.
Yeah.
And then there are thousands and thousands and thousands of others,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I can't think of any I've ever read about that didn't have as its centerpiece some guidelines encouraging its followers to be kind to themselves,
mm-hmm.
kind to other people, and ideally kind to other life forms.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can't think of one. And all of them that I can think of encourage a deep reflection.
Mm-hmm.
You know, within the context of the cultural setting of that tradition,
mm-hmm.
but however it gets expressed, it's think about it.
Yeah.
It's about relationship, right?
Mm-hmm.
So for you, I would assume it's your relationship with you,
mm-hmm.
with your husband,
mm-hmm.
family, friends,
yeah.
the Ummah,
yeah.
Allah,
yeah.
right? Relationship and right relationship.
Mm-hmm.
So in the photography I'm talking about, it's also about right relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And by being honest with yourself, that's where you start.
Yeah.
That's where you start. In Buddhism, there are four noble truths, four
mm-hmm.
guidelines. And the first one is that life contains difficulty or suffering,
mm-hmm.
right? So dukkha. So that's just where you start, is that life can be hard.
Yeah.
I don't know anybody for whom that isn't true.
Yeah.
And then out of that recognition that life is difficult, ultimately comes an encouragement to be compassionate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Not only toward others, but towards yourself. Be kind.
Yeah.
Be kind. So the photography I'm talking about is grounded in kindness. It's about encouraging people to look at who they are for real.
Yeah.
And if it's junky in there, okay, it's junky in there. Let's air that out a little bit.
Yeah.
Let's work with it artistically. Give it some space to breathe. Let it go.
I love that. We have maybe 2 minutes left before we get to this portion.
Okay.
Do you have any closing thoughts about the topic that you'd like to share?
I think, I didn't come with any prepared statement, but I guess what I would say as a closing thought would be that photography can be a very powerful vehicle for personal expression,
mm-hmm.
and that for an individual to express most strongly what they're best at, to hit their talent, as Pierre would say, to focus on their talent,
mm-hmm.
you have to self-reflect and you have to go
mm-hmm.
deep.
Yeah.
You have to be courageous and kind and compassionate
yeah.
to yourself. Go deep. And once you identify what makes you go, like for me, it's the significant early event I'm referring
yeah.
to, then you can start shaping your images and what you're going to do and what you're going to say in line with what is most true.
Mm.
And your images will become quite strong. So it's based
true.
On personal
mm.
truth.
Yeah.
And so I guess
yeah.
my final word was don't be afraid.
Don't
Find
be afraid.
People you trust and work with them.
That is beautiful.
Don't be afraid.
Don't be afraid. So now what I usually like to do is have the artists share some of their own pieces. So I'm going to get out of the frame and I'm going to let you probably bring some and you can just put them in front of the screen as you wish and describe them. How's that?
That sounds fun. See how this works.
Oh yeah, you can use the chair.
What about the
window? Oh, you know what we can do? We can. How's that?
Let's Okay, you're not going to be able to see me, but that's okay. I'll talk and you'll see the image, hopefully. There we go. There we go.
Should I move it back or is it good?
It's going to be okay, I think.
Because I can move this
I
back.
I can be headless. Go ahead, move
I'll
it move back.
This, I'll move this back a little bit.
Okay, and I'll sit. So this image, I'll sit. Yeah, this is fine.
Is this good?
So this is a very large version of an image that I photographed right after my father passed away. I lived on a small lake in East Lansing, and we had two nights of absolutely stunning sunsets, unusually rich sunsets. The first night I didn't photograph, I was depressed. I was grieving my father's death, and I did not get off the couch. And I said, well, if we get a second night like that, I'm going to go out there. So we had a second night. I knew that there were reeds out there. I wanted to see them.
Yeah.
And I loaded my camera gear into a kayak.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't get in the kayak because none of my camera gear was insured. And so tripods, camera,
yeah,
lenses, like, you don't want that wet.
Yeah.
So I put it in the kayak and I tied the line at the bow of the kayak to my waist and I waded down into the mud and I walked through the cattails with the kayak and the camera gear behind me.
Oh, wow.
And then after a while, as I walked, I knew it would get shallow. There were sandbars or mud bars, and
yeah,
I came up on those and these reeds were out there. And I photographed, for those of you who are photographers, I used an extremely shallow depth of field. This was shot at F2, which means that the reeds are focused, but every bit of the background, the lake, all this brown up here, this is actually a reflection of trees a quarter of a mile away in water. Sunset, and it grades into the deeper and deeper blues where I was standing. So I don't have a problem using Photoshop to achieve color, but actually this is what it looked like pretty much to my eyes that night. It was an unusual night. I like the simplicity of it. To me, this reminds me of Asian art a little bit, but it comes out of I was in a place where I was extremely sad. And when I look at this image, first of all, it's probably my first abstraction. And it reminds me of my father, who I think of as an artist. So this remains one of my all-time favorite images. And the title of it is Haiku Reads. That's
I like that. All right. What's next?
Okay, this is a companion piece. I photographed this on the same occasion. So here you can see, hopefully, a reed here and a reed here, and the same magnificent sunset background.
Mm-hmm.
And the tripod was all the way covered in water.
Oh, okay.
So the water was several feet deep. It's probably 3-4 feet deep.
Yeah.
And my camera was sitting on top of the tripod, so this very expensive camera and lens was only about this far above the water. So if any boats went by, it would have been a big problem. But I wanted to try and catch the colors, and so I wobbled my knees in the water. And when I did, the ripples started picking up the colors. So there are lavenders and oranges and reds, and it just grates all the way up. And I call this one Basho's Reflections, Basho being a famous Zen poet.
Okay, that's beautiful. Yeah. I love the color grading.
Do my best to keep the glare off of these for you. So this, it's an abstraction. Well, I guess they all are. Initially this was called Rust Rock, and then because I was in art shows, I tried something fancier, and I called it Wegener's Calligraphy. Wegener was the guy who discovered tectonic plates. And the reason
that
I tried that
cool
name for a while, it was a little bit much, is that this is a piece this is a rock, and it's about 12 to 15 foot tall.
Oh, wow.
So I actually walked across this before I photographed. I actually walked across it. This is big. And I love the rust color in the blues. So it's about color. You asked about form earlier, but if you look, it's about form also. So it's color, it's form, it's the composition. And for me, I love the fact that this is marine sediments. This is mud that came from Hawaii or somewhere farther away over millions and millions and millions and millions of years. And then it was smashed and crushed and heated up and turned into crystals. And then rain and seawater washed some of the crystals away, leaving this fabulous design.
Yeah, I love them because they're nice little swirls. And but then you do have sort of the straight line, but it's nice. This is nice.
Yeah, so we'll just leave it as rust rock.
Rust. Keep it simple.
Keep it simple. I'm going to show you two more color, and then I'm going to show you one that's not color, just because I think it's also important. Let's see. So this is called Feather Light. These are all feathers, part of a Christmas wreath at a cousin's house. I photographed this toward the end of a day where the light was coming straight through the window, through the feathers, and it ended up with multiple layers of light. So you have light at the level of the feathers. These sparkles right back here that you can hopefully see is sunlight coming through the bushes. And then farther, actually the fine mist up here is sunlight coming through dust on the window. And the dust is made out of soil, out of quartz, and it shines. So you end up with light here, light through the dust, and light through the bushes. You end up with three levels of light. Wow. So this is feather light.
Can we bring it a little closer?
Sure.
I can see some of the...
Wow. There you go. See a little bit.
Yeah. Very nice.
Got it. Okay, this one is one that's always popular. I have produced this as small as 8x10, and I have produced it as large framed as 5 feet by 6 feet. This is 30 inches by 40 inches. And I call this one Liquid Sunshine. And the story behind this is that I was in a hotel room in Florida on a photographic trip with a very, very, very good friend who liked to sleep. And we got caught in a major leagues rainstorm. And so we went back to the hotel room. I'm just going to kneel so I can talk to you.
Yeah.
We got caught in a major rainstorm. We went back to the hotel, and I was bored. He was sleeping. It's the middle of the day. I'm bored. So I open up the curtains, and across the way is a touristy hotel with all kinds of bright lights. And I got on a chair and I set up my tripod, my lens, focusing only on the rivulets of water produced by this super heavy rain. And the way I focus the lens, you can't see the parking lot, the cars, nothing. So this is looking all the way across at this brightly lit hotel through the rivulets. One of the coolest things about this, and I didn't know it until later. I'm gonna see if we can bring this closer. I don't know if we can show you this or not. But like right here, this side is orange or tangerine, which is picking up this. This edge is green, lime green, pistachio green, which is picking up this. So what's happening is every single rivulet, every river of water is reversing the colors behind it. And if you were able to see these little drops backwards and upside down, they show the railings and even the hotel lights. Wow. So this has layers and layers and layers. It's most basic
that
layer.
Is
it's
incredible.
Just really, it's really color, 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 yeah. color. Right? It's just
wow.
all about color. I'll show you one more that's very different. So the thing about color is that at its best it expresses emotions. But sometimes a scene doesn't call for color or doesn't have color. So this is an image I call Chandler Oaks, and it was taken definitely in the dead of winter up in Lansing. It was about 5 or 10 below zero when I took this. So you see two solitary trees, and then there's a little line of landscape. So there isn't a lot of color in here, but it still reflects the emotion. And I would say, for those of you who are interested in photography or painting or sketching or music or whatever, mm-hmm. it's about the emotion. And the emotion with this was quiet, contemplative, mm-hmm. and yet they're touching, right? So different people bring different associations mm-hmm. to this image. But it's all about the emotion, and for those of you interested in form, whether form matters, it absolutely matters.
Yeah.
Form matters, color matters, or absence of color.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes that's exactly right.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly what a scene calls for.
Yeah.
Because you're trying to talk, right? You're trying to say something.
Yeah.
And it's the saying something that matters. As long as it comes from the heart, and this absolutely comes from my heart,
mm-hmm.
comes out of that initial difficult experience I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
I love this one because when I saw it, I felt stillness.
Right.
And I love that. Very nice. These ones? Very good.
Yeah, let them go.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. I'll put the light back on so we're a little bit brighter. I really appreciate you being on the show.
Thanks.
And sharing with us how self-reflection and really honoring our own truth creates this beautiful art.
That's really it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I appreciate it.
You're very welcome. Shukran.
Have fun. With that, we are done with this episode of Digging Deeper. I will have your work, any websites you have and whatnot, I will link those so you guys will be able to see his work. Do you have work online?
Not really.
Can they check you out on Facebook?
Yeah, on Facebook for sure.
Okay.
There will be a website, but yeah.
Just think future. It'll happen.
But on Facebook for sure, and I'd be happy for you to look at my work and talk to me. You know, send me messages, feel free to ask questions, whatever.
And maybe take your class.
And maybe take the class, absolutely.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much. We will be back next Tuesday. I'm really excited. We are going to be talking about the connection between dance and spirituality.
Ooh,
next week. So
that sounds awesome.
Yeah. So tune in next week, 7 o'clock Tuesdays. Till then, have a wonderful week. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.